I will call Luca Barra from University of Bologna. Luca Barra is a senior assistant professor at Bologna University, where he teaches radio television history, and he published two books and several essays. So maintenant nous allons donc écouter Luca Barra, qui est assistant professeur à l'Université de Bologne et qui enseigne l'histoire de la radio et de la télévision, qui a publié différents livres et un certain nombre d'essais, qui va nous parler de Shaping TV Seriality, Production, Distribution and the Unstable Border of Comedy. Thank you.
Okay. Merci. Bonjour à tous et merci beaucoup à Marta Boni pour l'invitation à ce colloque et merci aussi à toutes les personnes qui ont parlé hier ce matin pour leur présentation très intéressante, la discussion qui a suivi. Je n'ai pas un français assez bon et je parlerai en anglais. So I'm switching to English. And in my speech, I will focus on the redefinition of recent television comedy in the United States. So after the morning all around the world, we are coming back to the US, which I hope will help us to better understand how in the contemporary television scenario, distribution methods can influence and modify forms, textual models, and established genre definitions. So I would like to start actually from far, from a successful and probably abused recent concept which emerged both in the media industry and in the journalistic and even in some academic discourse, the idea of peak television, peak TV, as first formulated by FX Network's chief John Landgraf, implying at the same time both the great variety and quantity of spaces available now for television and audiovisual content and the subsequent increase in production necessary to fill those spaces and to make them noticed by the audience. This concept has become a tool of analysis, as you can see from the graph displayed here. It's insight and research information from FX Network, but it has become also a common buzzword, a part of the shared talk of the town between professionals and also between fans. But this is also a maybe too easy and double-faced rhetorical instrument. It is a way to underline, of course, how powerful the television has become thanks to the multiplication of the outlets, the screens, the networks, the channels, the products. But it also is the clear definition of an economic, symbolic and cultural problem. The offer is way more than the demand. A lot of possibly good shows are not watched, not discussed, so are ideas and resources wasted in some ways. We have not enough time to see, to catch up all these hundreds of original new programming every year. As this line of dialogue taken from the comedy show Billy on the Street shows well, this is the golden age of television. It doesn't matter if anyone is watching it. Of course, Billy Eichner, if you know him, was screaming that. I won't do that. There are so a lot of shows, a productive effort to fill a lot of distributive spaces, but also often a creativity with little results and little effects on the audiences. Here I want to add another criticism to this concept, also from another perspective. Are we sure that this kind of quantity, this lot of different titles, and the exponential growth in the number of single production really means there is so much more television out there? Maybe, as we will see it in a minute, there are more titles, yes, but with way fewer episodes and fewer seasons for each title. So I decided to focus my research on the evolution of forms, formats, distribution modes, and the consequences of all of this in times of peak television, non-linear programming, binge-watching, and so on a single genre, comedy series, on a single country, the US, in order to narrow down at least a little bit the corpus of this mapping, of this analysis, whose result, I think, can also be useful to understand other TV genres and also maybe other countries. Moreover, sitcoms and comedies have been, and I quote, the axis around which broadcasting revolves. And this is a quote from Gilbert Sells in 1956. And still nowadays, sitcoms are an omnivorous genre, difficult to define, with unstable borders, but also able to include, to dissect, to re-elaborate a huge number of different elements. This is the reason it is a perfect field where production, distribution, textual and consumption elements connect and overlap, a crucial genre in the relationship between long-term seriality and content circulation, and a great standpoint for some reflection on contemporary television. Due to the expansive choices of players like Netflix, Amazon, Hulu, HBO, FX, and many others, in fact, the classic half-hour format has started to be used for other kinds of serial narratives, while the idea of comedy has been stretched, or at least partially modified, to include new tones, new characters, ways of writing, and so on. So, contemporary US television comedy, then, is an important field of experimentation, of trial and error, a special blend of mixed traditions and innovation. If we focus on formats and on the complex relationship they have with production models, distribution platforms, scheduling, and so on, we can first select some of the main trends involving the TV genre in this respect, highlighting the main trajectories, while at the same time setting the ground for an analysis on how these changes impact and influence both the narrative level of the sitcoms and the ways they engage and connect with their audiences. Joking a little bit with a very successful slogan, putting it upside down, we could easily notice how, as I was saying before, in the age of peak television, often more is less. Meaning that, together with the great abundance and availability of high quality, high value content, at the same time something gets lost in the way. So these trajectories are at least partially double-sided, contradictory parts of an extremely mobile scenario. First, the strong historical connection between the half-hour length of the episode and the comedy series looks at least partially weakened, loosening the bond between genre and format form. While dramas are adopting the half-hour form as well, some comedies are choosing to develop along a full-hour format. It is sufficient to have a look at the Emmy nominations for Best Comedy Series. Of course, there is the stretching the boundaries to get an award strategy, and sometimes it worked, but I think this is a larger trend where comedy, but which kind of comedy, can be expanded in its narrative elements. Secondly, an even more important trajectory involves the length of each season, which is often shorter and shorter. Peak TV means a lot of new and different productions every year, but at the same time, these productions often do not reach the duration of classic sitcoms in terms of episodes and seasons. To quote a newspaper article, he's there, 10 episodes is the new 13 and it was the new 22. This trend is pretty common across all the genre. However, it is particularly evident in comedy, where the most successful classic sitcoms at their peak can reach 24, 25, or even 26 episodes per season. Now, comedy shows can have a very small number of episodes, with 12, 10, even 8 or 6 episodes constituting a season. In this respect, one of the key factors is the increased circulation of also foreign TV comedies in the US on-demand libraries, and especially the success of British comedy. Just to quote a name, Fleabag, a 6-episode series, UK series, easily made the top 10 list of the best 2016 TV series, but we can name also others. Another big formal change for comedy is the lost, or once again the weaker connection between television programming and everyday socially shared temporalities. Historically, sitcoms, more than any other fictional genre, established a strong relationship with the period of the year the episodes were broadcast in order to follow the holidays, the seasons, and the other aspects of long-term temporality. This connection is of course weakened by the shorter seasons and by the different use of time made by cable networks and on-demand platforms. And it completely disappears when the distributive model of the one-day release is adopted, flooding a single weekend with several hours of content, as Netflix does. While binge-watching works very well for several kinds of dramas, actually the connection with comedy is changed at a deeper level by this distribution method, which allows a full immersion but inhibits the establishment of the complex texture between viewing and leaving times that makes the comedy really work, thanks to a long-term commitment and to repetition. As a consequence of the other trends, another trajectory is the inability of a lot of contemporary TV comedies to occupy the entire season. Even when they are scheduled one episode a week on networks and cable channels, a lot of new titles are confined in a single portion of the year, or they are divided into two or three batches of episodes, working also on a narrative level, with long hiatuses in between. We will see some example. Another stuff, this is pretty new as well, some titles are starting to break the rule of one season per year, with longer pauses in production and, of course, distribution. Last but not least, different distribution platforms with varying business models lead also to other changes in the forms of the traditional comedy, giving every episode, for instance, some more minute and some more space for jokes and the closings of narrative arcs, thanks to a reduced amount of advertising and promotion in between, or to the complete absence of commercials on some platforms. This is not new, of course, but at the same time, the recent years have seen some radical experimentation on this side, with sitcom episodes of unstable length, according to the creative needs of screenwriters and showrunners. Some of the traditional constraints imposed by network television are lost, but as we have seen often in this conference, we have still to fully figure out the consequences, both positive and negative, of such a loss. On one end, creativity can have more freedom, of course, but at the same time has no longer limits to overcome, to play with, rules to follow, to sometimes break. On the other end, also the on-demand platforms have limits, constraints, and mediations of their own, thus establishing new ways of television storytelling, different narrative structures, and so on. For instance, if the three-act composition on almost every sitcom episodes on network television was a consequence, on one side, of course, of the entire narrative tradition of the Western world, but also of the positioning of commercial breaks, well, the comedy without commercial and without a strict defined length, an exogenous length, works different on many levels. So putting together all these trajectories, changing completely or at least partially modifying the format of US television comedy could give us the impression of something like a linear evolution. First there were the networks, then the original comedies from basic and premium cable channels, and the last step of this continuous and direct improvement in narratives and formats is the launch of non-linear and on-demand digital platforms. Often the journalistic and public discourse follows this revolutionary rhetoric of disruption and constant upgrading of aesthetics, offerings, possibilities, and so on. Well, another point that I want to make here, studying the landscape of contemporary comedy series, is that there is no such thing as an automatic progression. Instead, the evolutionary logic is always counterbalanced by the persistence of previous outlets and their parallel constant repositioning. There is undoubtedly an evolution in formats and languages of Netflix and Amazon comedies, as we will see soon, but at the same time, some of these changes and innovations also bounce back on other platforms, and at least in some cases, they can have there a larger impact, for instance, because of the larger mass of audience involved. I will make just a few examples. First of all, the space for the most innovative and relevant comedies in the last few years is not an over-the-top operator, is a cable channel and even a basic cable one. For sitcoms and comedy genres, FX and the little brother FXX have become a brand and a creative factory full of experiments, able to get prizes, high ratings, to create new subgenre, for instance, all the Louis-inspired autobiographical comedy, and to establish an imagery. John Landgraf is not just the responsible of the slogan Peak TV, but also the chief of a new blend of TV comedy, later copied by many, including Netflix. A second example of this imperfect evolution with random elements, progressions and comebacks is provided by Sam Titus, who started on network television and later continued on on-demand platforms. With a revival, as in the case already quoted yesterday by Giulia Taurino, of Arrested Development, or with the natural prosecution of a narrative, as with the Mindy Project, first on NBC and now since season 4 on Hulu. It is true that here on-demand platforms give a second chance to the products the network cannot afford any longer. But at the same time, this connection is valuable, and the non-linear platforms build a lot on the already established mass audience of some brands, trying to bring a good part of these viewers inside their own subscription service. A third example of this fluidity, then, is the presence of some of the elements I was talking about earlier and of some of the formal trajectories of contemporary comedy also inside the network's programming choices. We can see here some of the examples. I do not have the time to discuss every one of them, but I want to especially focus on The Good Place, with its first season broadcast by NBC in the last few months. In this series, which is on network on NBC and has already been renewed for a second season, we can find a lot of the formal variation usually connected to cable and digital programming. The season is short, with 13 episodes only, spanned across a longer period thanks to a subdivision in two parts, 9 episodes in the fall and the other 5 in January and February. Every episode, as you can see, is clearly marked as a numbered chapter. The storyline that results in a huge plot twist in the last half hour of the season, but no spoilers here, is developed and written right from the beginning. In some ways, the first season constitutes an anthology, ready to start again, or literally to restart in the following season. Some of the aesthetics and practices of the cable and digital comedy are then being constantly mediated in a show like this with some of the resisting rules of network programming, resulting in a high-profile title critically acclaimed and seen by many. The Good Place has been and still is an important experiment, a way network TV not only shows it's not giving up, but also is perfecting and expanding what other platforms are doing. Only in the next few years, however, will show us if this is an exception to an increasingly traditional network environment or a new norm for producing and distributing relevant comedy. So after highlighting some of the changes in format and distribution modes affecting the comedy, showing how these changes are not happening only on non-linear platforms, but across the entire television system, in the last part of the speech, I would like to show how these changes impact strongly on the unstable borders of the comedy genre, and on how comedy narratives are constructed and a close relationship with the audience is built. Traditionally, sitcoms works on two levels. The first one is laughter, reinforced by the laugh track, closely connected to single jokes, puns, awkward dialogues, funny situation, which is what Brett Mills calls the comic impetus. The second one is what I call affect, the creation of a familiarity, of a bond towards the characters, of a different connection which substitutes the laughter with a smile. The comic mitigation, as stated by David Mark, with other purposes. The joke obtains the laughter, the repetition of similar situation builds the effect. So I think contemporary television comedies, for all the reasons stated above, loses now, at least partially, the second kind of connection, due to the smaller number of episodes and seasons, to the lack of temporal alignment to the viewer, to the reduction in seriality and repetition. At the same time, they have to reconstruct a certain kind of connection with the viewers and to rebuild their narrative structures accordingly. So what can they do, and what they actually do? I will show you some example of two different opposite paths, at least we can say two poles of a continuum, at least partially able to explain some contemporary fads. The first path is the one that you can see here, makes the comedy closer and closer to drama. in several mixed forms of the so-called dramedy, with the reduction and sometimes the almost complete disappearance of the jokes of the light-hearted approach typical of sitcoms and comedies. We can have a look at the titles displayed here to get a large number of examples on both cable channels and digital platforms. Girls Looking at Togetherness on HBO, where melodrama element is very strong. Love on Netflix, which focuses more on the quirky relationship between the characters, more than the amusement of the viewers. You're the Worst on FX, which in its second and third season shifts from an abrasive comedy to a serious reflection on depression and mental illness. On Amazon, of course, there is Transparent, with its cultural struggle, putting together queerness, Judaism, and upper class, but also One Mississippi, for instance, which is the six-episode comedy, in brackets, by comedian Tig Notaro, elaborating the death of her mother, her own breast cancer, and so on. Even Mozart in the Jungle can have together laughter and intricate subplots, while Woody Allen's comedic miniseries, Crisis in Sex Scenes, can be considered also a single 2.5-hour long play with acts and a sort of space and time unity. What matters here is that the shift toward dramedy, or at least a semi-dramatic single narrative, is at the same time a choice and a necessity. If you do not have the time to develop familiarity and affect, if you no longer have a close connection with the rhythmical everyday life of the viewers, one of the ways left to make the audience feel something is through drama and melodrama. Therefore, drama is way quicker than comedy in stimulating passions and emotions, then substituting often both the laughter and the affect of the traditional sitcom in this kind of comedy. This trend is so wide at the moment that even a very traditional multi-camera sitcom on CBS, which is Two Broke Girls, as displayed here, can make fun of it, as you can see in the two screenshots here. Between the purposes of some contemporary comedy, laughter is no longer a necessity. The Netflix comedy is not funny. Not always, at least. However, there's another possible path, a completely opposite direction. This is a return to the episodic nature of the comedy. With vertical storylines that often do not have any horizontal development and do not leave any marks, often reaching a quick conclusion at the end of the episodes or even at the end of one of its inner sections of the episode. The most innovative forms, then, are also in some ways the more traditional ones, with an episodic structure. In the new scenario, once again, this is a choice and a necessity at the same time. A consumption of the episodes free from any constraints and temporalities, with binge-watching or random choices of single shows, can lead to narratives able to develop inside a single episode, or inside a restricted number of extremely connected and homogeneous episodes. The first episodes of a new series set the characters, the structure, the tone, and the kind of humor of these comedies, but then the following episodes and the subsequent seasons often prefer disconnected episodes devoted to single topics, which are more effective in establishing a short-term connection with the viewer. These comedies are made by non-sequiturs, leading to a rapid laughter and establishing an easier and low-degree kind of affect. You can see here some of the possible examples, but I want to focus on some others. Two from FX, the FX Factory. Atlanta, the one on the left, is one of the surprises of last year, and actually it is skipping this year to come back on air the next one. So once again, one breaking of the rules. After the first two or three episodes introducing the characters, then it switches location and topic for every one of its eight installments. There is the episode set at a basketball game with a black Justin Bieber, the one in the nightclub, the one built as a local talk show called Montague, the one at an elegant reception, the one adopting the point of view of the female lead instead of the male protagonist, and so on. In a similar way, and on the right, you can see some screenshot about that, men seeking women, reconstructing the single life of a young man looking for a partner, and in its third season, the entire development on a relationship till the marriage, which aired last week, fills its episodes with an always renewed imagery, with scenes inspired by science fiction, war movies, actual politics, and a lot of other stuff, in a collection of sketches, reading everyday situation through the distorted lens of television, B-movies, popular culture, and so on. Other two possible examples come from Netflix. Come from Netflix, following more or less the same road to conquer a place in the viewer's attention. So Aziz Ansari's Master of None builds the episode independently, one from another. It's actually Master of None presents and then distinct, discrete episodes, which one after the other have a different color, a different style, a different location, a different topic. Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, originally developed actually for NBC by Tina Fey, but rejected by NBC and produced and distributed by Netflix, adopts sometimes the structure of the web memes, with the single scenes having particular resonance, and the narration looks just like as an excuse. Even when we have a three-episode story arc about the Indiana Mall women trial, that becomes actually more of a parade of celebrity cameos than an actual advancement of the plot. So in the end, to draw some quick and of course very temporary, unstable conclusions, we can first of all note that not only there is an obvious circularity between the ways of distributing television and the forms and formats of comedy, the former modeling an intended audience and the latter adapting to it, but also these changes have a huge impact on the narrative and the structural aspects of comedy writing for television and on the ways these shows build and maintain the audience engagement through laughter and affect, and now often through some melodramatic elements or intra-episodic one-liners. I would like to stress, as a fundamental part of how television comedy works, the relevance and the value of repetition through long-term programming and through reruns, which counterintuitively is at least partially disappearing in the theoretical constant availability of infinite on-demand libraries. At least some of the shapes contemporary comedy are taking are reaction to this loss, the loss of repetition, and ways to find, hopefully, other triggers, other ways to be seen and to be relevant. If comedy has always been a high-risk business with flops, cancellations, even some of its traditional strengths are now, the connection with the audience, are now at risk in the contemporary scenario. And I want to conclude quoting the New Yorker TV critic Emily Nussbaum in her review of one of the titles I used as an example, The Good Place. She speaks about the growing pains of a new sitcom, of course making an inside joke. These growing pains of a new sitcom are becoming even bigger in a system with a huge offer and a very limited number of solid pillars to build it on. So, thank you.
So, thank you, Luca. We have 10 minutes left because the session should finish at 12:30 and we start the new one at 1:30. So, I will be very strict. No?
15 minutes so, more.
Okay. We want to one question, yeah.
I was just I'm here, Mark. I was just sorry, I'm French, so it will take a little time. All the
tu peux parler français, je comprends.
That's fine. I'm gonna do it in English. All the new sitcom or all the example that you showed on screen were what we call the one single camera sitcom. And I think that when Scrubs did the shift to in front of an audience to a four camera to a one single camera shot sitcom, it changed the dynamics. And so when you change that dynamics in front of people and the laughter track and everything, you open up another dimension the dimension of dramatic dimension. So maybe that's the shift. It's a bit more free for the creators to explore other ways of other narratives. What I was trying to say is that shift. We saw the same thing with the numérique, with the numérique. It was the democratization of creation. And I was just wondering if you thought about that shift, starting with Scrubs and then evolving in other things, because now that mainly sitcom are what, one single camera sitcom, only at least the successful one. There are some exceptions like Big Bang Theory, but all those one
you
single...
You have to define successful because
kind of a complex in terms of people watching, just... yeah.
That's but the point, because multiple camera, four camera sitcom, traditional sitcom, are still nowadays more and more and more seen than all the comedies I was talking about.
Yeah, yeah, but my point is the only, and that's where I'm gonna adjust my last saying, is that the only, unless I'm wrong, the only shows that have syndication in the US, which mm-hmm. means there's more than 100 episodes or something like that, and it's more, that means more money, are only the classic one, like the four single camera. Maybe Modern Family is going to be the first one, one single camera sitcom to achieve, to attain syndication, but there's still that, they haven't breached that that limit.
No, thank you very much for the comment and question, because there are a lot of interesting things to pick up. First of all, the four camera versus single camera model. Actually, I kind of left that apart, because it's kind of a previous change in the ways sitcoms were made. There are a lot of also network single camera sitcoms with several degrees of success. The single camera sitcom models has influenced in a bouncing back effect also the four camera sitcoms. So we have actually some hybrid four camera sitcoms, which have also insertions of different kind of a production model. So I wanted to take a step ahead that, including in the first wave, in some ways, both multi-camera and single-camera sitcoms with a lot of episodes, with a lot of seasons. Of course, often the single-camera sitcoms are more expensive and have less a lesser number of seasons or higher stakes for success. But at the same time, I think this kind of change is kind of independent between the two different models. It's more inside the larger thing, unstable, explosive things, which is comedy. I can quote rapidly just the experiment of a four camera traditional sitcom made by Louis C.K. on HBO, which was Lucky Louis. Nobody knows about that. It was awful, but despite that, it's there are shifts, there are connections, there are a constant evolution on that. You were talking about also the digitization factor and the transfer to that. Of course, it is important. Of course, it's relevant. But once again, it's more of a well-established scenario. I was focusing on the last 3-4 years with the titles I quoted, and that was why, because there are already at work and operative and with production, a lot of production, all the on-demand services, all the cable networks, and so you can look better to all this interplay. Last thing, it was, I do not remember, there was a syndication. Syndication is another crucial aspect. I said in the conclusion that one of the losses, and it is very a strong loss for comedy, I'm convinced about that, is repetition. And syndication, of course, was one of the main devices of this constant repetition. There's the work of Derek Compere, for instance, on the rerun of this kind of product in American television, but it stays more or less the same also in other places, also in Italy, etc. This is another thing. We do not know yet how it will work, the relationship between syndication and nonlinear platforms. If you can sell to a higher, with a higher amount of money, your rights, your license rights to Netflix, why bother doing also the syndication? And so there are more classic sitcoms because those deals were made before, or because syndication connects to an older and aging audience. And so you continue to show to them all the episodes, of course, of Seinfeld, there's nothing best, but also of classic sitcoms from the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and so on. So once again, that's an interesting thing to see. I think it's part of this loss of the repetition effect, which together with the synchronization with viewing times actually makes comedy work. If we were talking before about the imagined community, if there's not an imagined community who laughed at the same time, the comedy, you're laughing alone, and laughing alone is pretty much stupid. Sad.
One question behind you. Yeah.
I'd like to thank you for your great conference where I believe you brought a very interesting change of perspective on one might think maybe because of the author theory that comedy moved to dramedy because of a maturity in the genre. And you actually mentioned something that sometimes we forget as scholars, that production, producers, syndication, formats, distribution, most of the time they have the final word on what the final product will be, either on TV or on television. My comment, have you thought about that impact on animated comedies? And I'm thinking of two very important examples. The South Park is now much shorter in terms of episodes, and in a way, in the wrong way, they are more dramatic because now each season is a full-on story. Every episode follow each other's. Well, The Simpsons have lost, and the fans are complaining about this, their dramatic dimension, and now they are only comedic episodes that are with very absurd humor. And I was wondering if, according to you, one of the reasons might be all the elements you mentioned during your talk.
Okay, so once again, other very useful comments. The aspects of the author is also the problem of quality. I tried to give another look at the same aspects, not to undermine the idea of also writing choices. There are important and great comedians, writers at work on this kind of comedy. But there is also the other element. You can do that by choice because you want to do the quality comedy, but you can do, and often you do that the same also for desperation, in order to get the attention of viewers, which are in the age of peak television, on whatever we can call it, dispersed, fragmented, and it's difficult to gain their attention. If a comedy doesn't get their attention, it dies. So with the drama, it's different. There are different connections. The other stuff on the animated comedy, I think these are some of the factors at play with the changing happening on the South Park and on The Simpsons. I'm very, very afraid and desperate that Simpsons are becoming more and more like Family Guy, and it's terrible, it's blasphemy. But I think there are also other aspects here on a production level, because we are talking not about new series, but we are talking about long running, and in the case of The Simpsons, record running series. In this case, there's also another aspect which is very important in production, which is the increasing costs of every episode, of every single creative figures involved, the dubbers, the animators, the authors, and that explains also the shortening of the season of South Park, for instance, because there's also this problem. You have to, with the seasons advancing, you lose at least part of your viewership, because you cannot get any new viewers, and at the same time you are losing the ones who are loyal to you, and at the same time the single episode costs you more. So you have to take into account also this aspect.
Another question?
I'll try to be quick. I'm wondering about the, you didn't talk about Louis that much, and I think
because
that...
it was first.
Okay, yeah. Well, so I'm interested in tracing kind of a continuity of, or let's say a continuity in a change framework. Yeah. Louis would be, you know, breaking completely with, you know, very deliberately with the formulaic, you know, it's an anthology in a way. Sometimes it's a serial, sometimes it's an episode.
More than an episode inside one single episode.
Exactly. Or if we look at whether he uses his own distribution on his website, then he doesn't even hold consistent the length of the unit, right? Okay. And another, I don't know if this falls within your perimeter, but something like Drunk History is a show that started as a 10-minute online show, very, very smart, very low budget. But what I'm trying to point out with that is that when we look at web series, a lot of time we forget these people are trying to get a TV deal, you know? And so they had a 10-minute, now they made it almost the structure, right? They put three of them into a 30-minute, and there you have it. They have a TV deal, more money comes in, the production value increases, and I personally was not familiar with it before it was on,
Comedy Central, yeah.
So, you know, we tend to be like, either everything is new now, or everything is the same, so...
My point is that everything blends, and you cannot forget history. You have never to forget history, and disruption is bullshit. This is my point. But after that, but maybe it's a personal point. And Louis, of course, I hadn't talked just a rapid quote with the FX case, but it was in some ways the father series of some of these innovation. The first place where, with a more authorial centered and less commercial centered way, some of these innovations were introduced and worked. Later, it starts a path of industry taking some of these authorial clues, authorial forms, and putting them in their production as a standard practice for some kind of purpose. Actually, there are some series I quoted as the Thich Nhat Hanh one, One Mississippi, or I haven't had
Atlanta,
the time
right?
to talk about... here Better Things, which are two series co-produced by Louis C.K. Together with other two
comedians. Baskets.
Baskets, of course. I have actually just put all the series I've seen in their entirety. So as you can see, it's already an exaggerated amount of time I passed in front of the television or the PC.
You write it off as research, man.
Comedy. It's research. Yeah, I can tell that. But the second part of the question, the Comedy Central series here, Broad City, has done more or less the same with the two comedians, which add a web series and then get a full series. And at the beginning, it's more or less as a mix-up of some of their web series, and later it becomes a more complete episodic form, but still very episodic. Or inside Amy Schumer, which worked more or less that way. Here there is another boundary, which is a little bit blurring between the comedy shows and the sketch comedy shows, which I'm still trying to figure out. Actually, I was very doubtful about whether to include or not inside Amy Schumer here, because it's actually more of a sketch comedy show, even with some comedy series conventions. But it's another aspect to work with, to work on.
Okay. That's it?
Oh, no.
Oh, Marta, yeah?
No,
d'accord, Marta, okay.